Thank you. Good morning and welcome to worship at First Presbyterian Church in Tupelo on this second Sunday of Easter, this first Sunday after Easter. This is a grand day as we worship again online. I hope you are with us watching, and I hope your young children are with us and ready for the children's moment in a few minutes. Just a couple of announcements. Please continue to remember Bobby Dale, who suffered a stroke last week and is recovering. And he is still in the hospital, still in CCU, but expects to begin rehab this coming week. So that is wonderful news. Also, last week I mentioned during worship that perhaps it would be nice to have a laughing track. It's rather difficult preaching to an empty congregation, at least in the sanctuary. And then I received a gift. After that comment, I received a gift this past week. It's called Instant Audience. Instant Audience. So listen carefully to see if you can make out what these sounds are on this Instant Audience. The first one. Applause, right? And we Presbyterians don't clap in church. But I can use this now. The next. Crickets. That's often what I hear, at least it sounds like what I hear when I tell a joke in church, even when the church is full. Now the next. See if you can make this out. And finally, perhaps after a rather boring or disappointing sermon. May we prepare our hearts to truly worship God. Please join me now if you have your bulletin. Hopefully you're looking at that on your iPhone or maybe your computer or iPad. May we join together in the call to worship. On your feet now, applaud God. Bring a gift of laughter. Sing yourselves into His presence. Know this, God is God. He made us. We didn't make Him. We are His people, His well-tended sheep. Enter with the password, thank you. Make yourselves at home. Talking praise. Thank Him, worship Him, for God is sheer beauty, all generous in love, loyal always and ever. Let us worship God with joy. May we be at worship together. Our opening hymn this morning is hymn number 104. Amen. Thanks be to God. May we now join together in the invitation to confession. None of us likes to look foolish, but which is sillier? Chasing after the world and all its gaudy trinkets which flatter our souls, or being a fool for Christ, imitating him in service to others, offering ourselves in love and joy to the world. Let us admit to God the foolish choices we make each and every day. As we say, praying, "You know us, you know better than we do," amused God. "What important people we believe we are. Believing we have to be serious all the time, we miss out on the joy of your creation. Choosing to feast on the pain of the world, we skip the picnic offered in paradise. Clinging to despair, which is our best friend, we ignore Jesus, who can bring us home to your heart. Forgive us, heart of joy, and make us open to the startling and upside-down ways in which you work. Fill us with Easter's laughter. Fill us with your healing joy. Fill us with the love poured into us through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior." Amen. And now the words of forgiveness. The gospel tells us over and over again of the joy which comes to us through Christ. When Jesus was around, lives were changed. The sick were healed. The sorrowful began to laugh with joy. The good news is that this joy is now given to us. Through the Holy Spirit, we are gifted with joy. We are set forth to bring good news to the oppressed, to bring healing to the broken, to anoint everyone with the oil of gladness. Thanks be to God. We are forgiven. Amen. And at this time, I certainly invite all the young people to gather around for the children's moment. Good morning. Again, it's kind of hard to know where to look in this sanctuary, but I hope you've gathered around your TV or your iPad or whatever you're watching. I'm glad that you're here, and I miss you. This is very difficult, a difficult time for the church, a difficult time for all of us. I have a picture that I want to share with you this morning. It's a picture of a flower. Perhaps you saw this flower this past spring. They're already gone. I believe it's a dogwood flower. Can you see that? Can you see the dogwood flower? Let me tell you a little story. Perhaps you already know the story of the dogwood tree. Many believe that Jesus Christ, the cross that he was nailed to, was made from a dogwood tree. A dogwood tree. Well, they used that cross, they used that wood to make a huge cross, and he was nailed to it. But after his resurrection, Jesus said this about the dogwood tree. He said, "Never again will the dogwood tree grow as big as oak trees, as big as they grow now." Because back then, dogwood trees were huge. They did indeed grow as tall and as big as a big oak tree. But now, Jesus said, now they will never ever be able to grow large enough to produce a cross. And then the flowers, he said, the flowers will represent me. And I want you to look carefully. And if you have some dogwood tree still blooming, go outside with your parents following worship and pick a flower and look at it. If you hold it a certain way, the petals form a cross, right? Reminding us of the cross of Christ. And on each end, sometimes it looks like a nail hole with some dried blood on the tips of the petal, reminding us of the blood of Christ. And then in the middle is a beautiful crown. It's a little flower, a bud right in the middle of the flower. I don't know exactly what that is called, but we view that as a crown today, the crown of Jesus Christ. So again, when you go outside, perhaps you can get your parents to help you find a dogwood tree and look at the beautiful flower, because it reminds us of the story of the crucifixion and the risen Christ. Can you do that for me? Sure you can. Again, I miss you very much. God bless you, and I want to see you soon, hopefully in a few weeks. Let's say a prayer together. Dear God, we thank you for beautiful flowers. We thank you especially for the dogwood tree and its flowers, the flowers that remind us of the Easter story. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Please turn with me now to our reading of the morning. It comes from the Gospel of Mark. Mark chapter 16, verse 1 through 16. And may we listen very carefully for God's word to all of us. Again, Mark 16, 1 through 8. And when the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, bought spices that they might come and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, they came to the tomb when the sun had risen. And they were saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?" And looking up, they saw that the stone had been rolled away, although it was extremely, extremely large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting at the right, wearing a white robe, and they were amazed. And he said to them, "Do not be amazed. You are looking for Jesus, the Nazarene, who has been crucified. He is risen. He is not here. Behold, here is the place where they laid him. But go and tell his disciples and Peter, he is going on before you into Galilee. There you will see him, just as he said to you." And they went out. They went out, fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment had gripped them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. This is indeed the word of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. May we pray together. Gracious God, we pause now to hear your word. Silence in us any voice but your own, so we will hear and faithfully respond. Amen. I have three rather short stories before we get into the meat of the message this morning. Billy Crystal said this some years ago. He said, 2,000 years ago, Jesus was crucified. 3 days later, he walks out of a cave. And now they celebrate with chocolate bunnies and marshmallow peeps and beautiful decorated eggs. I guess these were Jesus' favorite things as a child. Next. A man was driving his children to church on Easter Sunday. And he was trying to explain that Easter was when we celebrate Jesus rising from the dead. And from the back seat of the car, his three-year-old son shouted out, "Will he be at church this morning? Will he be at church this morning?" And finally, five-year-old Brian had a very, very special, a very important verse to recite at the Easter pageant. His verse was important, rather simple as well. It was this: "He is not here. He is risen. He is not here. He is risen." Unfortunately, he could not remember what to say, and the director had to quietly remind him of his line. He then confidently grabbed the microphone and triumphantly shouted, "He's not here. He's in prison. He's in prison." You know, it feels good to laugh, doesn't it? I think it does. It feels good to laugh. One of the earliest descriptions of Easter depicts it as a gigantic joke, a huge joke played by God on the devil. Conrad Hires, in his book, "And God Created Laughter," says this: "In the early Greek Orthodox tradition, an unusual custom developed. On the day after Easter, clergy and laity would gather in the sanctuary. They would gather in the sanctuary to tell jokes. The reason given was that this was the most fitting way of celebrating the big joke that God pulled on Satan in the resurrection." Today is the second Sunday, or the first Sunday after Easter. We Presbyterians call it the second Sunday of Easter. Now people call it this Sunday after Easter Holy Humor Sunday. Holy Humor Sunday. because we can laugh at the forces of death. But our gospel reading this morning, I believe, tells us a slightly different story. In this gospel, the Gospel of Mark, the resurrection does not provide a happy ending to an otherwise tragic tale. Instead, we are given a picture of the resurrection which shows a disquieting, not initially welcomed event. When the first visitors came to the tomb on Easter morning, they did not greet the empty tomb with unbridled joy, not with unbridled enthusiasm. Rather than being jubilant, they were what? They were afraid. They were terrified. Their response is not to joyfully spread the good news, but to flee from the grave as fast as their legs could carry them, and then to tremble in silence. At the foot of the cross, we might expect fear, but we assume that the day of resurrection would be filled with exultation, with joy. Yet the very fact that in the Gospel of Mark, we find the first reactions to the resurrection out of keeping with our expectations, that fact should lead us to ask if perhaps we have failed to see the resurrection in its proper light. Perhaps we are just too familiar with the story. And because of that, we have fostered a failure of perceptiveness. We trivialize Easter if we view it as just another happy, joyful, and even laughable ending. We need to ask ourselves why the empty tomb and the word resurrection would overwhelm the first witnesses with fear. I would suggest that those who were first confronted with the resurrection were fearful. They were fearful because they realized the resurrection meant that they could not escape the startling way in which God acts. Clearly, the apostles and women who followed Jesus were distressed and burdened with sorrow at the death of the Lord. Their lives seemed to be at a dead end. They wept brokenheartedly at the foot of the cross, but even though they were distraught, they quickly adopted the assumption that Jesus must remain in the grave. Yet they were still ready to serve him. Our scripture this morning tells us that they brought spices to the tomb so they might anoint him. What else could they do for him in his death? They had come to terms with the death, and they acted appropriately, right? They did the right thing. Is there anything wrong with that? After all, we must come to terms with death, disillusionment, and grief if we are to continue living in any kind of fruitful way. It's only right. It is only right. But what caught the early followers off guard was the fact that God had chosen to act through death and suffering. Yes, the disciples followed Jesus in hope. Yes, they were ready to make certain sacrifices. Yes, they dreamed of a better future and they lived in Jesus' promise of an abundant life. But they did not expect God to accomplish the wondrous purpose of love through suffering and death. They had rebelled against Jesus when he told them of his coming end. They refused to believe this sort of thing could fit into the plans of God. Not abuse, not rejection, not humiliation. In the face of this, it is understandable that the first words spoken by the angelic messenger at the empty tomb were not "rejoice and be glad." Rather, "be not afraid." While fear was the first response to the resurrection, it was not and need not be the last response. For the one who has risen is the one who loved them and loves us unto death and beyond. The love of the crucified and resurrected one is the perfect love that casts out fear. Despite any reason men or women may legitimately have for fearing the resurrection, this fear soon makes way for tremendous joy. For in the end, we must come to see that it is the love of God which is the power and purpose behind the resurrection. The resurrection of Jesus Christ is the point in history. It is the point in history where the loving power of God was focused with such concentration and intensity that the lives of those people who were touched by it, ignited in brilliant flames of faith, spreading the joyful light of God throughout the world. There was a rather strange incident that occurred in Wichita, Kansas, some years ago. A fire had broken out in someone's house without apparent explanation. And after an investigation, it was concluded that it was highly unlikely that the fire started by arson, accident, faulty wiring, or anything along those lines. But upon going over the evidence again and again, the authorities finally decided that the fire was started by a highly unlikely combination of factors. Evidently, there was a stained glass window hanging in the living room, and as the sun beamed through it, just at the right angle, the effect was like a magnifying glass. A ray of sunlight was concentrated and focused on one piece of furniture, and that one piece of furniture, that couch, burst into flames. In the resurrection, we find the living purpose and redemptive energy of God concentrated on one point. And the result is staggering. Life bursts forth from death. Hope comes out of discouragement, and victory leaves defeat in ashes. In the resurrection, God focused divine power and concentrated divine purpose. And those who encountered it burned with new life. No, the resurrection is not just another happy ending. The early disciples initially found it to be a terrifying ending. But then they came to know, yes, then they came to know that it was not an ending at all, but a rather brilliant beginning for you and for me. Thanks be to God. Amen. May we join together now in the affirmation of faith, which you have printed in your bulletin. May we say what we believe. We believe in God, who made us in his image. We live, we love, and we laugh because we are like him. We believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God, our Lord and Savior. He had the last laugh on the devil when he rose from the dead. We believe in the Holy Spirit, co-equal and co-eternal with the Father and the Son, our counselor, our guide, our motivator. He is our joy. Amen. May we pray together. Gracious God, we give you thanks for this Sunday after Easter, what so many call Holy Humor Sunday. We thank you that we can indeed celebrate, that we can laugh. Gracious God, we celebrate that where people are gathered together in love, you are present and good things happen and life is full. We celebrate that we are immersed in your mystery. We belong to each other into a universe of great creative energies whose source and destiny is you. We celebrate that your spirit beat in the heart of Jesus Christ. The good news of your healing, embracing, and liberating love was heard by the broken, and the lonely. We celebrate that the spirit of peace and hope is present with us and through us. In our struggle to love, we incarnate your holy presence in our world. And so, aware of the hurts and longings that all of us carry, the awe and wonder that is around us, and the gifts of faith and this community of faith, we pause. We pause and we become ever aware of the sacredness of our lives. And we pray all of these things in the name of the one who was crucified and the one who rose, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now join me, if you will, and as we join together in the benediction. May the God of surprises bring smiles and joys to the everyday and ordinary. May the God of love be seen in all we do and say. Go forth rejoicing, for the good work has just begun. Thanks be to God. Amen. And again, happy Easter. God bless you.